We have big news today at TalkNorth.com and across the Viking Kingdom. And I'm talking, of course, about the new Arctic Warrior uniforms. We'll spend this show talking about nothing but the all-white uniforms, because I know nothing else is going on. Of course, I'm kidding. We'll get to the Justin Jefferson deal. And what it's great to have Jeff on this network for so many reasons. Experience, knowledge, expertise, ability to talk from an agent's or a an employee's or a general manager's or a president's perspective on the NFL. But in particular, one of his great strengths is explaining the salary cap, how it all works out, why people panic about the cap when they shouldn't be. So we'll get into the cap ramifications of Justin Jefferson's deal and whether it will allow them to sign other players, because it's actually a pretty good deal for the short term for the Vikings. So this is Jeff Diamond's Vikings and NFL Insider, part of TalkNorth.com. Best way to listen to this show or any show you like at the network. Please subscribe to your favorite podcast app. And we do appreciate you listening. Check out the Viking Update Show and all of our other great sports shows and outdoor shows across the TalkNorth.com platform. Thanks to our longtime sponsor, White Bear Lake Superstore. Thanks also to Twill, Scott Dayton Shop in the Edina Galleria. All right. So we will talk about the Winter Warrior uniforms at some point, but this is the week to talk about Justin Jefferson's deal. So take us into the negotiations and the ramifications.
Yeah, Jim, I think first of all, it's a deal that the Vikings had to get done with their best player, a team leader, a team captain. He's the most popular player on the team by far among the fan base. His sponsorship endorsement opportunities have grown because he's got a pleasant personality. So it was really, I think, a deal that had to get done. I salute the organization for the commitment of the Wilfs starting at the top. And I've always said that successful pro sports organizations start at the top with strong ownership. And I think that that's been proven again, obviously, through the facilities, fantastic facility at TCO Performance Center, U.S. Bank Stadium, and just the money that the Wilfs have put into this franchise. And this is the latest example with the Jefferson contract, that their commitment to the $140 million four-year extension with $110 million guaranteed that makes it Justin deservedly the highest paid receiver, and something that I know that he and his agents were seeking, which they achieved, was to be the highest paid non-quarterback, topping Nick Bosa's deal at $34 million a year in new money with the 49ers. And so I think it's a real positive from so many angles. And yeah, we all expected the deal to get done. And yeah, he was signed on his fifth-year option. He could have been franchised. But to avoid hold-ins or holdouts or any more conversation about this contract, I think is positive heading into this week's mini camp and then on into training camp, not having that conversation. Everybody now is signed, and they can focus in on the quarterback decision and getting TJ Hockenson healthy and just getting guys like Aaron Jones into the system and JJ McCarthy and Dallas Turner. So there are so many positives with getting this deal done, but I think the biggest one is just having it behind them, a deal that had to get done. And I think it's really kind of created a situation around the league where now players such as CeeDee Lamb and Ja'Marr Chase, they know where Jefferson's deal is. It's where it was expected to be. It's where you and I talked about and I predicted a year ago that it would come in. I thought the agents would seek $35 million a year. That's what they got. I thought it would come in maybe a hair under that, but they got it done. I do think, Jim, on the structure of the contract, that the Vikings were, I would think, seeking a five-year extension to get Justin under contract for 6 years. They only got a four-year extension. I think that's a great move on Jefferson and his agent's part, because he can hit the market again when he's, whatever, 29 years old, before he hits 30, and he can reset the market again at that point in time. After players, there could be players such as Marvin Harrison Jr. or Malik Nabers or Roma from this draft class could be Puka Nacua. Who knows who's going to be the next trailblazer at wide receiver contracts. But I think that if Justin continues his trajectory, which is a Hall of Fame trajectory, production-wise, and stays healthy, more so than he did last year, I think he could certainly reset the market again in four more years when they do another extension. So I think smart on their part to do a four-year deal and still get the kind of contract and guarantees that he did get and get him to the top of the wide receiver market. And I think it's, as I said, a great deal for Jefferson, a great deal for the team. And the Vikings salary cap is really kind of the hidden value in this situation, because with the structure of the deal, with a $37 million reported signing bonus, with a low base salary for the next 2 years, $1.125 million this year, $1.17 next year, what that means is that the Vikings have freed up $11.2 million of cap room. And that, because he was hitting the cap for $19.743 million under his fifth-year option that was guaranteed, now with this new contract structure, the cap number dropped to $8.512 million. And so they've saved over $11.2 million. The big question, what are they going to do with that money? They've got about $26 million of room right now, and I believe it's the ninth most in the league, which is kind of rarefied air for the Vikings in recent years when they've always been tight under the cap, and largely because of Kirk Cousins' big quarterback deal. Well, now they have the benefit of a rookie contract with J.J. McCarthy, a low other contract with Sam Darnold. We'll see how their competition turns out. We know McCarthy's eventually going to be the guy, but they've got basically 4 years of low salaries on their starting quarterback. And if he's a player anywhere close to what Patrick Mahomes or Russell Wilson or some of these young quarterbacks early in their career gave to their teams, it's a bonanza for the Vikings organization. And so Jefferson's cap hit, very manageable for 2 years. What are they going to do with that money? That's the next step. I think, Jim, and we've talked about this before, I believe that this should open the door for them to reinforce their cornerback group by signing one of the quality corners that are still out there. And I'm talking about Stephon Gilmore from the Cowboys last year. Yeah, he's 33 years old, but he's coming off a really good season. 68 tackles, 2 interceptions, 13 passes defense, started every game. Xavier Howard, he's 30 years old. He's a 4-time Pro Bowler. Gilmore's a 5-time Pro Bowler. And you talk about Howard, who played under Brian Flores at Miami when Flores was the head coach there. Now, Howard's had some knee issues, so they have to check that out. But he had 12 passes defense and an interception last year. He's got 29 career interceptions. Gilmore, 31. And I think either of those two guys could be a big help, similar to what Patrick Peterson gave him a couple years ago, because I'm just not quite there where I'm trusting or where I've seen enough high-level play on a consistent basis from recent draft choices, Mekhi Blackmon, Caleb Evans, or Andrew Booth Jr. I like Blackmon, the best of those guys. Byron Murphy and Shaquille Griffin are veteran guys, but you still need a third and a fourth corner. Guys get hurt, as Murphy did late last season. As I said, I like Blackmon the most of those young guys, but if they could put whatever, $8 to $10 million of that 26 and go out and sign Gilmore or Howard, wow. I think then the team looks so much stronger. Maybe they put that money towards a third wide receiver if they're concerned about Jalen Naylor staying healthy. Brandon Powell, yeah, he's a good fourth. Trent Sherfield, they signed a free agency. He's a possibility. But they need to replace KJ Osborne. Naylor is the guy that they like, but he hasn't been able to stay healthy. So do they try to find another receiver? Do they try to reinforce the defensive line? There are a lot of options that they have this cap room. But the other thing you have to realize, Jim, on the salary cap, when you talk about $26 million of room right now, well, they still haven't signed McCarthy and Dallas Turner. That's going to cost them about $7 million of cap room. That takes them down to $19 million. And with that money, a good chunk of that's going to have to go to the final roster, because right now only the top 51 players count. And when you get to the final cut, then everybody counts, including practice squad, including injured reserve players. So some of that $19 million that we're talking about is going to go to fill out the entire roster. But I still think they've got room to sign a veteran corner or some other area that they need help. To me, it's the cornerback that I would address.
Why haven't those guys signed yet?
I think they're looking for more money. And Howard was under an $18 million a year deal in Miami, and he got cut because the Dolphins were concerned about paying him that much money and the fact that he has not been totally healthy the last few years. And Gilmore, I think it's maybe a factor that the Cowboys have had really significant salary cap issues this year because they did not extend Dak Prescott. And now they're looking at the situation where they've got to deal with CeeDee Lamb. Now they can get Lamb's contract as the Vikings did with Jefferson. They got his number down by giving him a big signing bonus, low base salary the first year. And CeeDee Lamb is counting close to $20 million right now, or $18 million as Jefferson did. And so they can also get that down by about $10 million bucks and then sign Gilmore. I think that's what they want to do. I don't think that the Cowboys are excited about extending Dak Prescott right now because of his playoff fiasco against Green Bay. I think that has really had bad reverberation, shall we say, for Prescott and for the Cowboys. And they're now in a situation where they're saying, okay, Dak, we'll pay you eventually, maybe if you prove it, you get us to a conference championship at least, or to a Super Bowl. And if not, maybe they like what Trey Lance is doing, and they're ready to move on after this year. We'll see. But I don't think Dak Prescott's sweating it too much. He's still making $40 million this year. But even still, he was one of the highest-rated quarterbacks in regular season last year and had that terrible game against Green Bay, through two bad interceptions in the first half. I think that's why Stephon Gilmore's still out there, because the Cowboys are waiting to get CeeDee Lamb done. They also need to potentially address Micah Parsons, who is eligible for an extension after his third season, kind of similar to where the Vikings are with Christian Darrisaw, and they may be thinking about putting some of that money towards Darrisaw. But again, that's not going to increase Darrisaw's deal that much when the way they structure with a signing bonus and first-year base, as they did with Jefferson.
Good stuff. I want to continue by talking about what this deal means for other wide receivers, what it means for the league's priorities, what it reflects about the league's priorities, that wide receivers are getting paid like this. Also want to talk more about the Wilfs. Right now, though, I'd like to hear more about White Bear Lake Superstore, whitebearlakesuperstore.com.
Yeah, thanks, Jim. The White Bear Lake Superstore, Buick GMC, with my longtime friend, owner Paul Rubin, general manager Charlie Guttrell, their fantastic staff, Minnesota's number one volume Buick GMC dealer, 6 years running with the best selection and their super friendly premium team. Check out their great website, whitebearlakesuperstore.com. You will see the new 2024 Sierra 1500 Graphite Edition with 1.9% APR, or buy as low as $39,995. 1.9% APR plus a $3,250 purchase allowance on 2024 GMC Sierra 1500s with the V8 engine, 0.9% APR and a $750 purchase allowance on 2024 Buick Encore GX, plus no monthly payments for 90 days on most of these vehicles, and see the all-electric 2024 GMC Hummer EV. The White Bear Lake Superstore is the Quigley 4x4 van superstore. They are a certified elite dealer. Only 7% of GM dealers make the cut. Visit in person at 3900 Highway 61 North in White Bear Lake, or online at whitebearlakesuperstore.com for all your vehicle needs and the premium experience. Buick GMC, we are professional grade.
Also want to thank longtime sponsor of the network, Scott Dayton, Twill by Scott Dayton, the Dining Gallery. Go check it out. Sign up for their email alerts, twillmn.com. They will not spam you to death. They'll just let you know when they have an event or a new vendor. Right now, they've added Samuelson to go with all the stuff that I love, the Johnny O, the Peter Millar, the Brax pants, the nice suits, the great sport coats, the golf stuff, the accessories, great for graduation gifts. Anytime, for any man in your life. They will love it. They will love the shopping experience as well as the quality of the products that Scott handpicks. Thanks to Twill. Twill and the Dining Gallery at twillmn.com. So let's start with the Wilfs. The Wilfs stubbed their toes a few times in the early years of ownership, but that was a long, long time ago. And now they have the beautiful building, the beautiful facility. They've been gracious with people like the Minnesota Aurora, letting them play their games there, which has been a great boost for women's soccer in the state. They never back away from spending money on a winning product. It seems like they've got it all going in the right direction.
Yeah, I definitely think they do, Jim. And talking about Johnny O, I had my Johnny O on at Randy Shaver's golf tournament this week. Which
so did
was
I.
A fun event.
I was there, and I was wearing Johnny O as well.
Okay, you must have been playing in the morning because I played
afternoon. I just never saw you. I was right in front of Bob Hagen and a couple of other former Viking employees.
Yeah, no, it was a lot of fun. But anyways, the Wilfs, I think that they just are great stewards of the franchise, and they are committed. They do what they need to do as owners, and yet they're not super ego crazy owners, as we've seen with the Arthur Blanks of the world and the Daniel Snyders and Mark Cubans, who always have to be front and center and on the sidelines. And I think it's great that they are there when they need to be. Their actions speak louder than words, and so I salute Ziggy and Mark and their families for the great work that they do in support of this franchise. And as we said, whether it's in the facilities or allowing other teams to use high school teams or the Aurora, whoever, using the TCO Stadium in Eagan. And then you talk about hiring people and letting them do their jobs. And I think that's what I appreciate most as a former team executive is to have that confidence of ownership, but yet understanding you have to keep them apprised of what you're doing. And that's what I always did, whether it was with the Viking group of 10 owners here or whether it was with Bud Adams down in Tennessee. And I think it's really critical to hire people and then let them do their jobs, but still stay involved as an owner so that the management people know that it's not carte blanche here. And I think Kwesi Adofo-Menzel spoke to that about the Wilfs, saying, hey, they want to know what's going on, and we have meetings, and as long as I explain it to them what the rationale is, they're all on board. And then they're going to say yes to Justin Jefferson's contract or to whatever player they want to re-sign. So I think it's a positive situation on so many fronts, and it will hopefully pay dividends for the organization if, and of course this is the big if they chose the right quarterback in J.J. McCarthy, or if Sam Darnold has a career renaissance, which, who knows? Anything could happen in the sports world. We've seen stranger things. We've seen Jim Plunkett go from the scrap heap as a former number one pick of New England and winning a couple Super Bowls for the Raiders. So anything can happen, but the expectation is that at some point, J.J. McCarthy takes over. When that is, it's going to depend on J.J. McCarthy and Kevin O'Connell and what kind of confidence level he has in J.J. But just kind of watching him in these early sessions of OTAs and minicamp, you can see that the guy's got an arm, he's got athletic ability, and I'm looking forward, as I'm sure all Viking fans are, and the coaches and the team and the players are looking forward to seeing J.J. in action. In obviously preseason games are a rather shaky test, but eventually he's going to be in the lineup when it counts. And unless Darnold just knocks their socks off.
No doubt. Hey, what does it say about the modern NFL that wide receivers are getting paid like this? And what does JJ's contract mean for other wide receivers who are trying to get paid?
Yeah, I think, as we talked about before, CeeDee Lamb is next in line. I expect him to come in between Justin's deal at $34 million in new money, and A.J. Brown got $32 million in new money. And so I expect CeeDee Lamb to come in at 33. And then I think Jamar Chase, and I'm not sure that they're going to be able to do his deal this year. He is eligible as a fourth-year player, but they may hold off on him until next year when he's going into his fifth-year option, as the Vikings held off on Jefferson, and then maybe do Jamar Chase. And I think he'll come in very close to where Jefferson is. I'm not sure he's going to top that deal, but I think he'll be really close to that 34 and then come in probably as the number two receiver. And then you look at down the road, as I said, it's going to continue. As long as the salary cap continues to rise and NFL revenues rise that fuels the cap, then player salaries are going to go up. And so you can expect in 4 years, when Justin is probably ready for another extension, the wide receivers could be making $45 million a year, $50 million a year at that point. Who knows what's going to happen in four more years because of the way that contracts have risen so dramatically, and especially with wide receivers who now earn more than double, or I would say almost double compared to the highest paid running backs. And you talk about Justin's deal at $34 million a year in new money. Well, Christian McCaffrey just got extended at $19 million a year, but that deal doesn't take effect for two more years. So he's really somewhere between 16 and 19 in his compensation. As I said, about half of what Justin's really making $32 million a year when you include his 19.7 for this year. And then you add in the $34 million a year going forward. So Justin's about double what Christian McCaffrey is making. And Christian McCaffrey is making a lot more than most of the other running backs. So it's just, you look 10 years ago, Jim, and this is what's really dramatic. The spread was just $2 million per year between the highest paid receivers 10 years ago. And that was Larry Fitzgerald Jr., the local product from here with the Cardinals at the time. And Calvin Johnson of the Lions were making $16 million a year. And the highest paid running back was none other than Adrian Peterson here with the Vikings at $14 million a year. And so what's happened in the last 10 years, wide receiver salaries have skyrocketed, especially in recent years, with Jefferson the latest beneficiary. And the running backs have basically stayed the same. So it's just kind of crazy what's happened. And the other thing that kind of is semi-shocking to me, 25 years ago, Jim, I signed Chris Carter, our Hall of Fame receiver, for $5.5 million a year. That made him one of the highest paid receivers in the league. I think he was behind maybe only Jerry Rice at the time. And now Jefferson's going to make seven times as much as what Chris made on that deal with Jefferson's new deal in 25 years. So it just shows you what's happened with player salaries.
Right. They're going to keep going up because league revenues are going to keep going up. And so the salary cap's going to go up and players are always going to have, you know, that short-term leverage, the ones who really make a difference. And the league is so rich, they can afford these deals.
Yeah, and now working in the agent business, I'm thrilled by it.
Yeah, and you should be. I have a lot of older readers, and they're nice enough to email me. And a lot of the times the line is, how can they pay this much? This guy can't be worth that much money. I said, well, you know, if you're talking about society, of course, a player shouldn't be paid 8,000 times more than an elementary school teacher. But in the world of the NFL, where you have every owner is a billionaire, every franchise is worth multiple billions, and the league is making billions of dollars, paying a receiver $35 million a year just makes sense.
Exactly. And people also forget it's the entertainment business.
Yeah.
And in the entertainment world. So if Meryl Streep could be paid $20 to $50 million per movie, and she might do a couple movies a year, why shouldn't athletes who have a shorter lifespan as top earners compared to movie stars, if they're successful? It's part of the entertainment world.
Right. And you know what? Meryl Streep, she wouldn't go over the middle.
Exactly. That's right. She doesn't want to face those safeties such as Harrison Smith.
Her nickname in the business is Alligator Arm. She would never stretch out for a ball, you know?
No, definitely not.
Hey, good stuff, Jeff. I always appreciate the Capology insights. Next week, we'll talk about the new Viking uniforms. We'll talk about some of the roster challenges, where they could go to solve them. We'll talk more about Reisner re-signing with the team. For this week, great stuff from Jeff. Thank you all for listening. We do appreciate it, and we'll talk to you next week.